Welcome! In this video, we will discuss the vacuum energy, which is actually one of quantum field theory's greatest problems. Now, what we will do here is just start up with the result that we got from the previous video, this here, which is the Hamiltonian for the Klein-Gordon quantum field theory. Now, if you don't know where this came from, it doesn't really matter. Here we are going to be more focused on the meaning behind the equations, and even though I will be doing some procedures, we mostly care about the meaning of what's going on here. So what we now want to do and what I will do is basically show you that the energy of the vacuum in the theory that we have created, right, in quantum field theory, is not zero. Now, and not only zero, but it's going to be quite problematic. So the Hamiltonian acting on the vacuum, which is what we have denoted by zero, will be, right, we let this part here act on zero, but that's going to give us zero because the lowering operator on the lowest possible state will simply give us zero. So that doesn't do anything. So we are left with this, which we can simply call E0 or something, right? That's simply going to be the energy, whatever its value is. And that, unfortunately, is going to be infinite. And now we're going to discuss it. Of course, the whole infinite part comes from this d cubed, right? This Dirac delta is infinite, and we're also integrating over it an infinite amount of times, or three times, but it's an infinite sum of those infinite terms. So we end up with an infinite amount, which is something very, very, very troubling, because that means that the energy of vacuum itself is infinite, which is very, very, very odd. Now, it's not necessarily impossible, at least a priori, without really thinking much about it, because we can only measure relative energies, right? We can only measure changes in energy. Energy transitions, for example, you don't measure the absolute energy, only the differences. So in principle, if you don't consider gravity, sure, it could be, but there are quite a few problems when you start looking underneath. So to understand where this problem comes from, let's take a look at the factors that are inside this integral. And the most important one is this del cube, right, the Dirac delta. So let's begin to study it by just looking at the Dirac delta in its definition, right? So if we take d3x here, the x we consider to be integrating over the entirety of space, EIPX over 2 pi cubed, this by definition is simply the Dirac delta cubed of p minus 0 in this case, so simply p. Okay, so we can of course multiply through by 2 pi cubed, so times 2 pi cubed, and now see what happens in the case where p goes to 0. So when p goes to 0, this will simply be the Dirac delta of 0, and this thing here is simply 1. So what we can see now is that this Dirac delta cubed here, and with the 2 pi, is related to that integral. And what is that integral? That integral is simply the volume of space. Right? That is simply what it is. And that, of course, gives us a good idea of why the Dirac delta is infinite, right? Because the volume of space is infinite. And that is where the problem is coming from here. We are integrating over an infinite volume, which of course is going to give us an infinite amount. And it's also, it really isn't what we actually want, because if you have some system in a place that you are describing using quantum field theory, you don't really expect the entirety of the universe to be acting on it, right? You expect things to go to zero as you get further and further away, right? Eventually, it should tend to zero. So there is evidently a problem here. So we call this, right, you say that here the problem is the contribution from long distances, right? Which of course will be the equivalent to thinking about very low energies. And this is what we say is an example of infrared divergence, right? This is a divergent integral, and it is infrared because it's low energies and, well, long distances. Now, in quantum field theory, whenever we have an infrared divergence, what we can interpret it to meaning that we are asking an unphysical question. So this means that something about the way that we have set up the situation is simply wrong. So, well, evidently, the problem is that we are considering an infinite volume, right? We should not be doing that. We should be somehow only considering a finite volume. So what we will do is what we say is regularize the theory. So we will say, okay, we are going to take a finite volume, right? We're going to take some finite volume, and in that finite volume, there will exist, you know, some finite energy density. Okay, so we will define the energy density epsilon zero. So this is energy density, right? And since it's energy density, it is the energy of the vacuum, right? This is energy density of the vacuum. So maybe let's make that clear. So it is energy density of the vacuum. So of course it is the energy of the vacuum divided by the volume of the vacuum, right? Which we can just say volume of, maybe not R3 because, well, let's just keep it for consistency. Okay, so just the volume of our space that we are considering. So here we just plug in the value of the energy, which we know is this part right there. And that, of course, well, is just going to be 1/2 integral d3p. Now the 2 pi cubes, they cancel out. So we have omega p and the Dirac cubed. Okay, and now we go to the volume part. Now the volume we know is this integral, which is now considered to be finite, and that integral is equal to this part. So this would be Dirac delta cubed of 0, 2 pi cubed. So the Dirac deltas, which were the problematic part, now they cancel out, and with this we have 1/2 integral. Well, I guess I can put the 2 pi cubed in the front. So let's write this as 1/2 times 1 over 2 pi cubed integral of d3p omega p. And yeah, that's it, nothing else. And now we can just study this further because there is actually a problem hiding inside. So even though this may look better because now we don't have the Dirac delta, we still have an issue. So let me write what omega p is. We know that omega p, as we saw in the previous video, is simply p squared plus m squared, right? So if we write this into our integral, we have 1/2, 1 over 2 pi cubed integral of now d3p, and instead of omega p, we have p squared plus m squared. And now we can solve some of these integrals, because if we're integrating over all of space, that means we're integrating from 0 to pi, from 0 to 2 pi, and from 0 to infinity, right? And we have to add p squared sine theta, right? That's basically what we are doing, writing this as dp. So this is dp, d theta, d phi. Now, just doing this very quickly, the angular integrals will simply give us 4 pi. So we get 4 pi, and then over 1/2 and 2 pi cubed, and then we still have the integral from 0 to infinity of p squared square root of p squared plus m squared dp. Now this integral is evidently divergent. So this is divergent, and why is it divergent? Because as pi goes to infinity, right, at the very large values of p, sorry, not pi, of p, then this integral goes to infinity. And even if we do this regularization process, we end up with what we call a UV divergence. Okay, so we have a ultraviolet divergence, which is divergence that happens because of the very high energies. Now, what this means is that our theory, the theory that we are creating, that we are just in the process of studying, breaks down when we go to high energies. And well, why does this happen? Well, the reason is actually because we did something when we thought of fields and tried to build a physical theory built on those fields, we made a little bit of an assumption, right? We said we have these fields, right? Let me just like draw them. Let's say that this is a field that are continuous, right? So this is some field that is continuous. But in real life, things are not continuous, because in real life, we have atoms that are finite and that are structured in lattices. So if we have some atom that has some linear size r, then you cannot have another atom inside of that same space, right? In that same distance R. So that means that as long as in our theory we are dealing with distances greater than this size of an atom R, then we are not really going to run into trouble because our assumption is true. We could have another particle be created somewhere over there, or maybe closer to the particle, right? That can happen, but we could never have a particle appear inside of another particle, right? That's just not something that can happen. So that is the mistake that we did. We assumed that we could go to any microscopic distance, but that's just simply not the case. Okay, so what this means is that the distances, let's say delta, always have to be greater or equal to the radius, or not radius, sorry, but the size of the atoms that we're dealing with. And this, of course, translates to the fact that the energies are going to have to be smaller than some cutoff that is usually used by the Greek letter lambda, capital lambda. Right? The energies always have to be smaller. Keep in mind, higher energies mean smaller, that's the word I wanted, smaller distances. And that, of course, means that if we go too small, then we are going to end up going past this, right? So we cannot have the energies go below this margin. So to very high energies, quantum field theory just breaks down. So what that means is that actually in the future, we need a new theory. We need a new theory. Quantum field theory breaks down at high energies. So if we want to study, right, we're going to need a new microscopic theory at some point. And there's actually quite a few attempts being made, string theory being one of them that actually even puts gravity into the whole thing. So that's very cool. And I will make a course about it, well, in a while. I have a lot of ground to cover before that, but it is coming one day. Okay, but before we get into that, of course, so this is the UV divergence. Now, what this means, of course, is that quantum field theory is merely what we call an effective description. So let me even write that down. So QFT is what we call, it is an effective theory, right? It is an effective theory, but it is not a fundamental theory. And we will look into this a little bit further, because quantum field theory, despite this problem, can still work as long as you stay away from that problematic energy range. As long as you are outside of it, quantum field theory gives rise to the best physical theory we have right now, which is the standard model, which can basically predict everything that we observe, or the vast majority, not everything. Quantum field theory does work, and there is a way to deal with the UV divergence, right? Because in a good quantum field theory, we can get rid of these UV divergences. And the way to do that is that we change the Hamiltonian, right? So d3x, right? We're integrating over the Hamiltonian density that we found in a previous video. So this is 1/2 pi squared plus 1/2 m squared phi squared plus 1/2. And here we had the derivative squared. And now we add one more term. So plus d3x v0. So we just add this constant term. And now when we take the energy of the ground state, right, we take the energy, well, all of this simply gives rise to the same result that we had before, right? That Hamiltonian is the one that, when written in terms of ladder operators, gave us this. So when we do that, we will get this E0 term, right? We will still get the E0 term. So the energy of the ground state here is given, of course, by letting the Hamiltonian act, sorry, not the ground state, the vacuum. It is obtained by letting the Hamiltonian act on the vacuum, and it's going to be the same as the E0 that we found earlier, plus now this term acting on the ground state. And the trick here is to choose our system in such way that that part, so basically in which d3x v0 acting on the ground state is going to be minus the exact problematic term that we had plus some chi acting on the vacuum. Okay, so that means that when we let the Hamiltonian act on the vacuum, we simply get this new chi acting on the vacuum. So what we just did, as I mentioned, is absorb the UV divergence into this new chi that we don't know a priori. We don't know what chi is. We do not know what this is. And in fact, we need to determine with experiments, right? So this means that we can indeed get rid of those problematic infinities, right, the UV divergences, but for each one that we get rid of, because there will be more in the future, we have to introduce a parameter that we cannot find from theory. The only way to know this parameter is by doing experiments, which is a problem in principle, because we want physics to be able to tell us everything. But quantum field theory is not, unfortunately, is not able to. It is an effective description. If you give it the parameter that it needs, it can tell you everything that you need to know, most of what you need to know. But it is not a fundamental theory. A fundamental theory would have no need for you to give any sort of input. That is the main problem with quantum field theory, and that is why eventually we will move on to try to find a better fundamental theory of physics. However, as you can see, we can indeed still work with quantum field theory, understanding its limitations and where we can and cannot do certain operations. So I hope that you enjoyed this video and the explanation. If you did, please make sure to leave a like on the video, comment and subscribe, and maybe even consider checking out my Patreon. So I'll see you in another video. Thank you very much for watching.